Yo, 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 this is King Midas, and you're listening to the Golden Debate Show. It's King Midas certified. Golden.
Down there in one of those.
Like, comment, share, and download earlymorningmobs.com.
Hit him with it.
Like, I don't know. This don't make no sense for everybody. Down there in one of those catacombs. There's other guys that they look like. I don't know. This don't make no sense for everybody.
The golden debate show.
Yeah.
The golden debate show.
Oh,
wow. Get that mac and cheese. Everybody deserves their mac and cheese.
The golden debate show.
Yeah.
Get that mac and cheese. Everybody deserves their mac and cheese.
Wow.
Turkey Day, will you be eating mac and cheese on Turkey Day? I know I will. That's very good in high class.
Holiday, every day.
Mac and cheese usually consists of chemically powdered cheese, but let's get it in, everybody.
EarlyMorningMob.com.
Down in one of those catacombs. And there's other guys that they look like. I don't know. This don't make no sense to everybody.
Hi, I'm John Green. Welcome to my salon. This is Mental Floss on YouTube. And did you know that pilgrims did not actually wear buckled hats?
Cheese,
I know, your whole life is a lie.
Buckles
didn't even become fashionable until the 18th century. And that is the first of many little-known facts about Thanksgiving that I'll be sharing with you today. I'll let you recover from the buckle thing during the intro.
Get that mac and cheese. Everybody deserves their mac and cheese.
Thanksgiving didn't have religious origins, so it actually is a great way to kick off your war on Christmas. And sadly, not the kind of harvest festival that features Lil Sebastian. Anyone, Parks and Rec? No? Just me? All right. This confusion usually comes from a failure to distinguish between pilgrims and Puritans. Both celebrated Thanksgiving on the North American continent, but pilgrims refers to any original settlers of Plymouth, whereas Puritans were what your English teacher kept trying to tell you about when you were studying the Scarlet Letter. For a better understanding of that distinction, look, I made you a crash course video. But of course, harvest festivals predated European colonists arriving in America, meaning that Thanksgiving didn't really originate in America. Plus, there was more than one first Thanksgiving. These celebrations that colonists brought over from Europe probably took place all over America, or at least the East Coast, at different times with different people. We do generally trace Thanksgiving back, though, to a 1621 three-day festival
celebrated by the pilgrims
of
punking the natives for their land.
Possibly,
thanks, everybody.
Also invited some Wampanoag Indians to join.
Get
so not only did
cheese,
the pilgrims not wear buckles, they also probably were not wearing black and white, especially considering that black fabric was extremely expensive at the time.
Now,
also,
from
the American Indians
the
were not wearing
pilgrims
white
or Puritans'
I mean,
point of view,
November,
they gave them a couple cows and some
cold,
axes for the land, everybody.
Myths. Here are some items that you probably wouldn't have seen at one of these harvest festivals back in the 1600s. Turkey, pumpkin pie, sweet potatoes, mashed potatoes, cranberry sauce. They probably had goose or duck instead of turkey. The meals might have even included swans or passenger pigeons, and also seafood. There also was probably nuts and corn and pumpkin, but no pumpkin pies. So this year, I challenge you to celebrate like real
Get
pilgrims
that mac and
share
cheese.
A lovely
Everybody
meal of
deserves their mac and
with
cheese.
Your family on Thanksgiving. What's that, Mark? They're extinct? Oh, that's too bad. Eh, whatever, a regular pigeon will do too. As for logistics, forks had not yet been invented, so the only silverware that could have been found at the meal were knives and spoons. Here at Mental Floss, we're all about educating, so I am now going to do a historically accurate demonstration of
Get
what
that
the
mac
pilgrims
and cheese.
Looked
Everybody
like at their harvest
deserves
festival.
Their mac
because
and
I'm
cheese.
A scientist, I shall now demonstrate how to eat bread with only a spoon and a knife. No wonder they were so hungry.
Capitalism.
Delicious. I'm just trying
thing.
To wake
For
you
a long
up.
Time, a
miscarriage.
More
I'm trying to wake you up.
Discussed now that communism is out of the picture. Capitalism is as anti-human a philosophy.
Get that mac and cheese. Everybody deserves their mac and cheese.
We should be consuming less, manufacturing less, selling less, transporting less. And what's the battle cry? Free trade everywhere. What does free trade mean?
Down in one of those catacombs.
This is a philosopher named Terrence McKenna. He's also a professor somewhere. He has a speech impediment.
And you will have no kind of sounds like a sneaky snake,
but he also brings up some good points every now and then. If you get past this impediment, everybody.
Stuttering Stanley?
No, it's not a stutter.
It's really... See, they try to tell you that capitalism and democracy are not... Actually, the whole Marxist-Leninist socialist thing was a
Like, I don't know.
The real life and death struggle is between capitalism and democracy. Democracy says everybody has an innate worth that must be honored. Capitalism says those who die with the most toys win. You cannot reconcile.
I'm just trying to wake you up, everybody.
I'm
trying to wake you up.
We're still having the party over the fall of communism. But, you know, you go to the Soviet Union or the former areas of the Soviet Union and you see that what it was a deep freeze for traditional culture. In Kyrgyzia and Turkmenistan, people are basically camel husbandry is what's going on. Now, with communism on the rocks, McDonald's will be there in 5 years, and Kmart will be following close behind. So I think we're coming to a great crisis of fundamental relations to our own fundamental institutions. I'm not anti-capitalist. I think capitalism needs to sever its connection to materialism.
What do you want to work for? This is going to be stopped.
This is, again, why virtual reality is
supposed to evolve.
You sell
not work.
Things
work is good for your heart, for your family, whatever you do, evolution, creativity.
I'm just trying to wake you up.
Kindness, compassion.
I'm trying to wake you up.
Work. Jobs, they can get fucked. Not that enough? Why do we have to do them? Everything's fucking built.
Get that mac and cheese. Everybody deserves their mac and cheese.
You got a house? Yeah. You got a toilet? Yeah. You got a pub? Yeah. Well, sit the fuck down and evolve, you cunt. Fuck this. Little creature. It's gonna be stopped working. It's a trap. It's a fucking trap. 5 days on, 2 days off. 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 But how long does this last till you're fucking dead? 5 days on, 2 days off. 5 days on. And it's not even 2 full days off, is it? It's not 2 full fucking days off, because Sunday's right next to Monday. Monday's going, can you fucking feel me? Hey? You can fucking feel me, can't you? If you didn't get up till 10 to 4 this afternoon. Be back in bed in about 2 fucking hours.
Get that mac and cheese. Everybody deserves their mac and cheese.
It's fucked. It's got to be stopped. It's a trap. It's made up by the ruling elites that we're tired and poor and can't rebel or philosophize about our own existence and actually fucking evolve properly. Instead of... Of course it is. It's slavery, but we've got to get our own accommodation and food.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Harry doesn't get it.
What the fuck it is? Isn't it some illusion they gave up slavery for morality? They did some fucking maths. Man, look at this. We've got to look after these fuckers. We've got to feed them. We've got to clothe them. They get sick. We've got to fix them. We've got to leave. I've worked it out.
I'm just going to wake you up.
Now. Well, tell them to fuck off. That's fucking brilliant. By the way, you lot, you're free to go.
Get that mac and cheese, everybody.
I'll see you back here at 7:30
deserves their mac and cheese.
Should be 2 days on, 5 days off. That way, everyone can have a job. There's not enough fucking work. 2 days. Who wouldn't do 2 days? I'd do fucking 2 days. It's common decency. And that simple fucking common decency. I'm on the earth, all right, fuck, 2 days, I'm in. Most people do 2 days. What's better than 2 fucking days as soon as you have your first day? What's tomorrow? Last fucking day, mate. Yes. Plus, some people would do more. See, we just think the world all has to be the same. Fuck that. I'll do two.
The real name, everybody.
Some people come up, you're like, what would I do, Steve? I'd met them, I'd be bored. Two? What the fuck would I do for this time? Did you get bored? No?
Yeah. One, two.
What do you do? Wake up, look out the window.
One, two. Hey, y'all, Wu-Tang's invincible. But I understand the principle. My man Bob's. Dropping fat tracks like drugs.
Get that mac and cheese. Everybody deserves their mac and cheese.
Interesting. Tell me to go.
30BoardingBob.com.
There's other guys, what they look like, I don't know! This don't make no sense for everybody.
Talking to Jeremy Scahill about his book, Dirty Wars, and the next call comes from Richard in Austin, Texas. Hi, Richard, you're on Book TV. Jeremy Scahill is our guest.
My call, I got a quick question for you. Now, we've seen the rise of Amy Goodman and Alex Jones in the last 2 weeks.
Get that mac and cheese. Everybody deserves their mac and cheese.
Still branching off the tree to spark the NEMC. And the fruit that fell far was the ripest. Get with Cypress, let the media hype this. Promotion niggas snipe this. Push it like Trey Badge in 72.
I'm just trying to wake you up, everybody. I'm trying to wake you up.
The mic so well, held without bell. Engines packed like gel cells. There's no escaping. Once my blade starts scraping, niggas flaking. Wanna be MCs shaking. My sword indeed make more niggas bleed so swift that and I couldn't record the speed. I lost ya with that offer, nigga that a caution. Fill the strings of torture. Must have been a half gal of shitty drinking. They got him thinking that if you trash the ship, you get me sinking. I told him come back when you show up. Drunk ass problems on a motherfucking hook.
I told you,
don't even catch me while I'm blunting. Rhymes start running like loops on a SV-12 honey. Instruments tell them what war shit
is. Now they one of those catacombs. There's other guys, what they look like, I don't know!
Meet the dark side, join us, you can be a golden king.
Like, comment, share, and download.
Yo, check the mic line for wiretap.
I'm gonna go to the next one. Ah, beholding this, travel ground like a motorist. Poisonous gas released from my track is odorless and tasteless. Yeah, like ghosts is faceless, which allowed the guard to break back and beat 100 cases.
Well, journalism is considered the most legitimate form of it. Alex Jones, who gets most of his money from the public.
I said open minds, not empty ones. Go to the beach.
Can you do that?
I want to be very careful in choosing my words here. I think that Alex Jones is a lunatic, an absolute diehard, insane lunatic. And I think to even mention him in the same sentence as Amy Goodman is an incredible insult to Amy Goodman. Alex Jones has forwarded some of the most outrageous, ridiculous conspiracy theories about how the world works. And whatever good he might be doing in some of what he does is completely overshadowed by the fact that he is pushing outright lies and propaganda on a regular basis, and I think it ultimately subverts the important real journalism that independent journalists are doing on a regular basis by giving the impression that everyone's running around wearing a tinfoil hat. And I wouldn't even put him in the same category as Amy Goodman on any day.
Greg is in Lewiston, Idaho.
Yes. Talking to Jeremy Scahill about his book, Dirty Wars, and the next call comes from Richard.
Data-driven instruction gives our teachers an opportunity to gauge where students are, their strengths, their weaknesses, to determine what we need to target for individual students that are missing particular areas in the curriculum. An example would be like this is, you know, we take our vehicles to the shop once a month to get the oil checked. And why do we do that? Because we want to make sure our cars keep running. We don't do it once a year. We're waiting for the end of the year, something's going wrong with the car and it won't run smoothly. Well, that's very similar to what we do with data-driven instruction. Every 4.5 weeks, we have common assessments. And from that data, our teachers break the data down with the principal and the curriculum team as well. We look at where our students are performing really good at, and we celebrate those growths. We celebrate them with parents, with students, teachers, and make a community aspect. And then we look at the areas that students have what we call hot spots. For example, little Johnny may not be doing so well in math. For a particular month, he may have some issues with fractions, and that data of the 4.5 common assessments we take will pick that up. When it picks that up, our team immediately goes to work to determine what Johnny did not get. We're going to reteach those objectives to Johnny. We're going to pull him out 20 minutes a day. We're going to work with him. Parental college support is probably one of the backbones of what makes this work. And we make sure that our car's running smoothly, if you will. We want to make sure that every student is successful, and that's your student that scores minimal to your student that scores advanced. Every student is important. Every student can learn. Every student can grow.
Allows us as teachers to see where students
ain't no wrong with that when you're young. You
in their growth. Obviously important to the parents, and we can show the parents in our data meetings and based on our data exactly where their specific child is. The student growth is most exciting when you see the confidence that they gain not only in the classroom but in themselves.
So as we look at the growths and from these students, we reward them for their growths. So every student, whether they score minimal or basic or proficient or advanced, they can be rewarded for this. It's kind of like opening a Christmas present. Every 4.5 weeks, we look at how our students are doing. And we really like celebrating those growths students make. I love making those phone calls to parents. Hey, Johnny did great this 9 weeks. I want to inform you of that. I want to tell you some good things you're doing. But we also like to give parents a 1, 2, 3 of what they can do to help little Johnny. You know, I'm a parent myself of a Tupelo student, and I always ask the teacher, and she's great at telling me what I can do to help my child.
Parents feel more comfortable when they know where their students are. And they
get
also
that mac and cheese, everybody. That deserves the mac and cheese.
They see whether it's a small growth or large growth with their child. They realize that their students are achieving at their own level and that they're making those gains at their own pace. In my experience with teaching over the past 20 years, data-driven instruction, not only does it drive the district to achieve in a certain direction and give us a direction to head to, but it also gives our students their direction.
Is that
we had a
follow directions.
Parent talk with us
don't
at
ever
a
think
recent
outside the
meeting
box.
Just last week,
and
fuck
the correct answer to one of the Common Core tests was, I think the problem was as simple as 6 times 7. And the correct way to answer that was to draw 42 circles. And I think the child was in third or fourth grade.
And the child wrote 42 for the answer and got it wrong. Because the lesson was, the mother told us, that math is, you're being too close-minded. We want you to be fluent in math. In other words, we want you to be able to talk about what math is. We want you to be able to explain why math is useful. We are not interested in you being able to do math. It's much less important to get the right answer. The word that she used in terms of the way it was explained to her at her school was estimative math. That the purpose of math is to be able to estimate, to be in a ballpark, to be able to have a sense of how math should function. And under the guise of anti-bullying legislation, if the government is teaching a lesson, or the government teacher is teaching a lesson about homosexual relationships, homosexual marriage, and your kid makes a face, or your kid slouches in her seat, or the pressure on your kid's mouse intensifies, right? Or blood pressure and pulse go skyrocketing,
well, then it's
fair to reason that your kid has the wrong attitude about homosexuality. Somewhere that kid is being taught to be a bully. And if your kid learned from you, mom and dad, that your faith tells you that homosexuality is wrong, then you're the bullies. You're the ones who are abusing that kid.
Even more trouble.
These are the kind of things that these things will measure.
May not, you know, be teaching their kids or
not teaching them.
Exactly.
These are effective sensors. that the Department of Education has developed and plans to use. That's what this document is all about, is how do we measure the students effectively? There is a facial expression camera. There is a posture analysis seat. There is a pressure mouse. And there is a wireless skin conductance sensor.
What's up with the...
Bare feet? Yeah. Teachers can be cool guys too, Marsh.
No, your gun.
Oh, that's right. The gun. Exciting, right? Well, a few of us teachers have been a little spooked by some of you students lately.
I'm looking at you, weirdo.
So every teacher's going to be carrying a gun from now on. And it ensures school safety. I couldn't be more excited.
Neat. But what if a teacher loses his or her temper?
Way ahead of you, buddy. Now, obviously, we can't leave all you students completely defenseless like sitting ducks. So we've decided we're arming all of you, too, with guns.
This is so cool. I know, right? Guns are the coolest.
Alright, you heard it here first, gang. The beholders of cool have spoken. When I call your name, come on up and pick out your very own gun.
I can't put my finger on it, but something doesn't seem too cool about this, Brad.
I know.
Oh, he's in third grade. Thank you, Louis. I asked all the kids what questions they want me to ask, because obviously this is a sensitive topic, so... Louis, you wanted me to ask you what you remembered from that day.
Yes.
I remember that a lot of policemen were in the school. I was like hiding under when we were having a drill. We were hiding under, like.
Take your time. There's no hurry.
I'm just trying to wake you up, everybody.
What would you like to say to your teachers about Friday?
Well, I didn't... I don't know, but it's like...
Wait, you appreciate your teachers?
Yeah, I appreciate my teachers. And thank me for helping.
The federal government of the United States have... can and will
get that mac and cheese
about any number of things. So much of what people believe about the Kennedy assassination is based on government pronouncements. And when
I'm just trying to wake you up, everybody. I'm trying to wake you up.
Apply that same thing to many other areas. In fact, I'd say this: if the federal government of the United States was an individual, we wouldn't have anything to do with him because he is a confirmed liar. Okay, let's not forget that we were told there was light at the end of the tunnel in Vietnam. Wow, yep. We've just about got it taken care of. There's weapons of mass destruction in Iraq. The air quality's perfectly okay on Manhattan after 9/11. Read my lips, no new taxes. If you like your health care plan, you can keep your health care plan. Come on, they just lie to you, and yet the media acts as a gatekeeper, and they will never tell you all these lies outright or put them all together.
Well, that's why I wanted to ask you, what do you think is the biggest wool that's being pulled over on the American people? You know, you've been doing this for such a long time. You're an excellent researcher. You always provide some really in-depth information that you don't get anywhere else, which I really appreciate, because it was one of your books, Ruled by Secrecy, early on when I was 15 years old. I remember looking at that book and reading it, and it made me see things from a totally new, different perspective. So I really appreciate that. But from your wealth of knowledge and research that you've been doing, what is that biggest wool that's been pulled over on the American people?
I think the biggest piece of wool that's been pulled over our eyes is that somehow government is our savior. It's our salvation. It's the nanny that's going to take care of us. And it's the exact opposite. The problem is the government. People all around the world, and I've traveled all around the world. I've been everywhere from Tibet to Mexico to Europe to Middle East. And I want to tell you, people around the world in general love Americans. And they love America. They love our freedom. They love our fashions. They love our movies. You know, but they distrust and they hate our government. And that's because we have allowed chiselers, cheats, criminals to get in charge of our government. And we have got to get this cleaned up.
Yeah. And if we're looking for a leader, we're going to get a master. I remember someone else saying that on Facebook somewhere. It's not me. It's not my original thought. But this brings me to my other question is, you know, just being in this for such a long time, what do you think is a possible solution to all the problems, all the misinformation, all the things that we are facing today as the American people? What is a solution to the problem?
Okay, for too many years, I've heard so many people say, well, leave it to Washington. Let Washington take care of this. And unfortunately, they have. And it's not a pretty picture. On
VHS, the Golden Show. It's golden.
EarlyMorningMob.com.
Like, comment, share, and download.
Golden Debate Show. Hit them with it.
The number of children with ADHD is rising, according to new numbers from the CDC. More than 1 in 10 children are now diagnosed with attention deficit hyperactivity disorder. ADHD cases have been on the increase now for at least 15 years. Experts think that's because more doctors are looking for ADHD and more parents know about it. Well, many consider them the good guys in the snack machine. A new major study says what you've heard about nuts is true. They are good for you. The study followed thousands of people for 3 decades. It found that those who ate 7 or more servings of nuts a week were 20% less likely to die from cancer and heart disease.
A fire heavily damages a duplex on the peninsula. How a witness came to the aid of some of the elderly people who were living inside.
Focusing on the concepts of justice and conscience.
Think about it. Globalization and technology means you can go just about anywhere.
The spirit that we will find our ultimate defense against the fictional system that currently enslaves us and that is getting tighter and tighter all the time. And when we have this community spirit, folks, we can address every single problem that we're facing. Ultimately, the problems that we're facing, I've said before, are all symptoms of the one problem, which is the corruption of the system. And that corruption
is there are a whole lot of reasons you ought to come here.
This community spirit. Even with cases such as Chappelle Corby being held in an Indonesian jail, suffering all types of abuse while she's in there.
Think about it. Globalization and technology means
designed to hold 323 people.
Think about it.
Globalization currently has 1,000 prisoners in there, and Chappelle Corby is completely innocent.
Think about it.
And we can write to our governments about this information. We can write to the governments. We can send them copies of Expendable all we like. And we should do this, and we should keep doing this, and we should let these people know exactly how we feel about it.
Think about it.
But ultimately, what will turn the tide is community action. It's when the people within the community decide that we're simply not going to comply with this anymore. And we're going to stop what we're doing, and we're going to turn and face the government and
after a decade in which they'd already been working harder and harder just to get by.
Not petition them.
It was a crisis from which we're still trying to recover.
To treat them like
but thanks to the grit and determination of the American people, we're steadily recovering.
Instruct them.
Well, many consider them the good guys in the snack machine. A new major study says what you've heard about nuts is true.
And don't tell me that the Australian government is not able to talk to the Indonesian government and at least have Chappelle Corby transferred
mac and cheese,
back to Australia.
Deserves their mac
and then
cheese.
Have the case reopened and all of the evidence actually submitted. And don't tell me they don't have the power to do this because they do. And what they also have the power to do is to approach the Indonesian government. There's various evidence that wasn't submitted, which indicates that this woman is innocent. And we would like you to look at this evidence and reconsider her case and please release her into our custody. Pending a full investigation.
Peace.
Of circumstances.
To the wiggle.
A river darchi. Sayonara. Aloha.
Now, our government has the power to do this, but they're not going to do it unless they are instructed to do so by the people. And again, folks, this isn't something that we need to petition. This isn't something that we need to request. This is an action that we need to mandate to our government that they carry out. Because ultimately, we're the people of the country. Hold sway. We are the country. We are the nation of Australia. We hold all the cards. And the reason our country is in the state it's in, the reason Queensland's being sold off to Chinese mining interests and the place is being fracked, the reason 90% of Australia's food bowl is earmarked for either a coal mine or a gas field, is because the people of Australia have been negligent in their duty to hold their government to accountability. And the same goes for the case of Chappelle Corby. The same goes for all of the problems that we face, folks. The problems of people being...